So we're starting up first game here.
Now I gotta say, as cameraman, this first video is really choppy because I've never done this before, and also I'm like sitting between two players, so I'm trying not to impede the guy to Brandon's right, and I'm also trying to get good shots. So sorry that this one kind of sucks a little bit, but the next two flow a lot better.
Yeah, I didn't plan very well for my seating arrangement, for considering that I would have a camera over my shoulder. I wish you guys could have seen, actually, our drafting arrangement, because we had some snug tables and snug chairs, and James was sandwiched basically in between four nerds, all brain sweating. it was pretty snuggly.
I was sitting on my knees in a circle of four dudes for about 25 minutes.
Well, thankfully, that's way too long to be perverted, so.
Now, you had to change your sleeves because we realized that you had two different colors of green.
Yeah, these green sleeves were given to me by somebody that was just going to throw them in the trash, and otherwise they're fine. And then it was just brought to my attention last week that they were actually two different shades of green. So right before the draft, I was like, oh, wait, yeah, I was just told I was cheating for a while, unbeknownst to me.
Okay. So you went down to six here. You got a Zealous Conscripts, which you bought him, or Zealous Inquisitor, I don't know.
Yeah.
He's zealous, man. He's excited.
So I was sad to bottom that, because I mentioned earlier it's one of my favorite cards to draft, especially in a limited environment. It's very powerful. But I needed lands, which was the reason I mulliganed away that first hand. And I was hoping for a Plains. He threw out Dragon Fodder, and I don't have an answer or good creatures to that in my hand at this time. So I was pretty much panicked and thought, these two goblins are going to take me to Crazy Town. Got more red. Got a lot of red.
That ended up being a problem in this game.
It was a problem.
Again, sorry about the crazy cam. Now I'm kneeling.
Yeah, he hit me with giant baiting, which I'd never seen before today. And he... Was it conspiring? When you...
Tap creatures to make it cheaper? Yeah.
You make another copy of it. So instead of hitting me with a 4-4, he hit me with two 4-4s on turn 3. So I was already at 12. And worried about what I'll be able to even play for my hand this game.
Yeah, you went down really fast.
Which, normally, I don't think I would be that excited about that card, but he did a lot of damage to me really fast. I sort of have a different evaluation level of it just from this one game.
Oh, yeah, I keep bumping into the guy to the right of Brandon. Like, I keep hitting his elbow, and I felt really bad.
This was a game of constant apology to the neighbors.
Yeah. And it's hard to see what the other guy's playing. I can't remember. But I know he beat Brandon in the face with it.
Yeah. This first game, you can probably tell how it's going at this point. I didn't fight a whole lot. Yeah, look at me, hesitantly playing that fourth land. Wishing it were anything else. Even a forest would have just improved morale, I think.
Yeah, there's a Gift of Orzhova in there.
There's a Core Skyfisher, Hookmaster, Duder. You got little Rosalka.
Yeah, Hellrider.
No way to get value for it. I guess that's a question. Why do you hold on to the creature that you could have played?
Well, I think I was trying to figure out whether it would be more valuable to drop him down and put him at threat, or if I wanted to get the Rosalka down and just chump block and sack for a turn. I think every turn I took to this point, and including now, I was pretty much trying to figure out, if I draw a Plains next turn, what would be best situation for me.
Okay.
So that's sort of how I was making my decisions.
I guess that kind of makes some sense.
I think my thought, even though a 3-3 would have been, you know, a little more valuable than a 1-1. Oh, 1-1 with First Strike. I forgot. I had the Soul Bond guy out. So I could still deter him from a little bit of his attacking, even with the 1-1. But I wanted to keep the Hellrider safe, because if I was going to make a comeback, it was going to happen for playing Hellrider, and then the following turn playing the Gift of Orzhova and gaining a bunch of life.
Yeah, that would have been a pretty
good turn. So I was basically planning on that as my out. Yeah, he decided to swing into me anyway. I was pretty much expecting a combat trick, but I couldn't just let him deal it to my face anyway. So I blocked his tokens in an attempt to lose as little as possible. As it turns out, I lost as little as possible.
Yeah, literally, right? Because you... Well, I don't want to spoilerize it. Oh, there's not what you needed.
Oh, yeah, that Cathari that has flying and then sacrifices for more tokens. That was stressful. I didn't have an answer to fly. Well, except that Gift of Orzhova in my hand, which I'm now halfway to being able to cast.
Oh, man, get
but
there.
But I was excited to get that Plains.
Right, that lets you cast two more spells in your hand.
Yeah, I've got options all of a sudden. Again, at this point, all of my thought process is, if I get a Plains next turn, how can I be most efficient casting either multiple creatures or the Gift of Orzhova on something relevant? So I was debating laying down the Hellrider.
Yeah, because at this point, right, it's not enough to just play a... You couldn't just play the 2-2 and then put the Gift of Orzhova on it, because it's going to run into the token from the Cathari bomber guy.
Right. The gift does give them flying.
Yeah.
As well. So the Cathari has flying, but the tokens didn't.
Oh, okay.
So my goal here was to sort of bluff a damage, because if he blocked, I just would have sacked it immediately. So I just got that free damage through before sacrificing it, because I decided to go ahead and play this and be able to soul bond it to give it first strike as well. So then I had a slightly better first striker.
And you tap an attacker, which is relevant.
Yeah, stop him from flying over my head and getting those tokens sooner. That black creature he's got out there was a sacrifice outlet also, so every creature he had he potentially could have sacrificed to deal another damage to my face, which I was already on the ropes. At this point, my opponent is asking me questions about how first strike works. And, you know, in a lot of situations, I'll just let people just run into their own problems and figure it out. But at Friday Night Magic especially, pretty much any situation at the common room, local store, I will always just explain to people how things will work and suggest you probably don't want to do that. He was debating attacking with his things. I was like, you're going to lose everything, pretty much. Not everything. He would get a damage through, but...
I don't think we've mentioned yet, but Brandon is actually a level 1 judge.
Yeah. I try really hard to build up the community. I always like to welcome in new players and explain to players how things work. Trying to keep it lighthearted in an educational sense, not trying to down talk to people, but just making sure they're not, you know, ruining their own fun with decisions.
You did just pull a lone missionary, and now I'm like, oh, look at that. Yeah. Lands.
More options, though. At least I can cast most things in my hand at this point. I am feeling a lot better. When I drew the Lone Missionary, getting to gain 4 life, I think I was at roughly 5 life. I was really low at this point.
Yeah.
I was feeling a lot better that I felt like I was going to recover.
There is a Plains at the end of the tunnel.
Do you know what the name of the ride is that has the Plains at the end of the tunnel?
No.
The Hellrider.
Oh, that's bad.
Yeah, you're welcome.
No, I think... Is it your turn still? Yeah. I think you're just running out the Hellrider.
Yeah, I just want a 3-3 to block. He played that 5-4, and I needed more incentive to keep him from killing me. Yeah. Oh, and again, playing towards the, if I drew another planes, next turn I would be able to put the gift on it, on the Hellrider, and just reverse the game. Like, all I would need is a swing with Hellrider, and I just would have won.
Yeah, because you, yeah, absolutely. Because it would have been, you gained 4 life, and deal him 4 damage plus the trigger off the Hellrider, and that's just
Hellrider attacking. Yeah, I would have gained 8 life. And been 8 to his face.
Mm-hmm.
Now, normally I think we'd like to keep you in suspense, but I gave away some clues real early on that that's not what's going to happen here.
This was actually the longest round that Brandon played, which was frustrating for me as a cameraman because my battery was very close to dying at this point, and I needed them to finish before, or I wasn't going to get the end of the game, because I'm not going to ask my opponent or the judge to stop the clock so I can fiddle. They managed to get there.
Yeah, this was weird, because I feel like his deck was kind of aggressive also, but we both just kind of came at the stalemate where neither of us drew much. Yeah, madcap skills changed everything for me on that turn, whereas it also turned all of his stuff sideways. So I was basically torn between, like, the two things I know I wanted to deal with were the two sacrifice outlets. Because he had two creatures he could sacrifice creatures to and deal damage to my face.
Still nothing.
Yep.
Here's nothing from a different angle.
So I had to make some less than efficient blocking decisions here, just for the sake of staying alive.
Now, I forget how you blocked. I guess we'll both find out in a minute. Looking at this, does it make sense to throw guys under the bus to kill the creature with madcap skills?
Well, thankfully, my two right creatures, they're soul bonded together, so they both have first strike.
Yeah.
So if I double blocked with them, either on the 5/4 worm or the madcap skills creature, either way, I was not going to lose those guys.
Yeah.
I decided to go with the one with the worm because it had one more toughness.
Mm-hmm.
And the evasion for madcap skills could have potentially proven to be a bigger problem. But I thought it would just be slightly easier to potentially kill that.
Yeah. Yeah, because you had a couple of burn spells still floating around.
Yeah, because it's a 4/3, and then the worm is a 5/4.
Yeah. So knowing the removal in your deck, it makes more sense to block the guy with the bigger butt.
Also, the sacrifice outlet on that worm is only 1 mana, whereas in the other guy, it's 2 mana, so he could do it slightly less efficiently.
Oh, I didn't even realize the worm had text. I just saw a big, fat, stupid worm.
I hated throwing away that Hellrider, but I actually had to. I think this put me... Oh, here, let's double check. Yeah, that put me down to 1.
Not what you needed.
Yeah, and everything in my hand is white, so I can only cast one thing. And the choice should be obvious because I needed that life too badly. It's a bummer. In retrospect, I think, looking back, had I cast this guy on the previous turn, I could have then this turn, I think, cast the Hellrider as well as that little red-white guy, and that would have been a little more mana efficient, and I would still have my Hellrider for the potential swing back. So I think that was a mistake, but kind of in hindsight after having a lot more information. But it definitely would have panned out better if I'd dropped the 2/1 life gainer first.
Man, the only thing I can say at this point about this game is that apparently foil Gift of Orzhova is like $6.
Really?
Huh. Yeah. It's a really pretty foil.
Oh, yeah, all the sort of stained glass looking wings.
Mm-hmm. I bet Sunhome Guildmage also looks good in foil.
You just love that card too much.
It's so good. I never even got to play with it. It pumps your team. It makes a dude. It's a 2/2 for two.
Oh, no. He's casting stuff. Oh, yeah. The Unearth. So I knew that was coming, which was why I had no choice but to gain the life. So he just swung with that. Put me down to 3. Got some more tokens. Thankfully, I got to keep my creatures. And I drew this miracle. Yeah. At an amazingly opportune time. He had lethal on board because of his sacrifice outlet that was going to deal damage to my face. So I drew that, almost popped it into my hand, which I know it's regular, and that could have been forgivable, but I really try and not, you know, take back things that would otherwise not be acceptable in other locations. So thankfully, I kept it aside with the miracle cards. If they go to your hand, they're technically, you're past that draw, so there's no confusion as to when you drew it. So I did that 5 damage to his face for 1 mana, which was something I really needed. That was very efficient. Well, not
to his face. To that little...
Sorry, well, as far as I was concerned, that little creature was my opponent. It was murdering me. Random note at this time, I believe my opponent is still at 20 life.
It's fine. We're fine here. There are no problems.
At this point, he's got 4 1/1 tokens. I've got 4 creatures. 2 of which have first strike. And now I've got Mountain Dew in my mouth.
I was sitting there thinking, man, we need to get sponsored by Mountain Dew because their logo is going to be on so many Magic videos.
Going to be impossible to not.
Oh, no.
Yeah, so that rage put me down to 1 with him having a single 1/1 more than I had blockers. He doesn't know that what I'm holding is completely useless. So I'm dead.
Oh, now we start game 2. That was the longest aggro game.
Yeah.
All right,
yeah.
So let's look at this hand. You got Hellrider. Yeah, you got 2 plains. You got 2 mountains. You can cast everything in your hand.
Yeah, not going to have color problems. I can drop out real quick out of the gate with my little Rusalka. I love seeing Hellrider. And that Golem Lord is great, too. People playing a lot of cards I'd never seen before. That's a little Mortician Beetle.
Yeah, he's really cool.
Really funny for him to play immediately after I play a 1-drop that sacrifices creatures.
Yeah, so Mortician Beetle is whenever your opponent sacrifices a creature. I think it's your opponent. Whenever you
Any player
sacrifices a creature, he gets a +1/+1 counter. So it seems like the perfect foil to the Rusalka.
So immediately going up to 24 with my opponent. You know, I felt like he was on the ropes. He basically lost at this point. I've got 2 creatures to his 1.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know why he didn't just scoop right now.
Yeah, we could have gone to game 3 at this point. Mog Flunkies, yes.
Yeah, you made an interesting removal choice with the Mog Flunky. I forget if it was this turn or if it's coming up. I'll talk about it when I see it.
I remember part of it was I didn't attack this turn. Yeah, I just passed to him. I forgot that I was thinking the Mog Flunkies could only attack with a friend, but they also have to have a friend to block. So I think I could have pushed both of those creatures through because he didn't want to block with that Mortician Beetle.
Yeah.
Or he didn't want to lose the Mortician Beetle.
Yeah. Now, at this point...
Or I could have blocked with either of them, rather, not both.
The game to the right of Brandon is finished, so now I'm sitting on the table next to them, and things start getting a little better, both for my own personal comfort and for the stability of the video.
And normally, I'm sitting pretty because I got 2 red mana. I can sack my creatures if he tries to kill them. But I'm really sad about that Mortician Beetle. I don't want to put counters on it. So I basically am treating that Rusalka like it doesn't have an ability. Which might seem minor, but it was frustrating.
Yeah, I mean, that his 1-1 blanks your 1-1 and trades with both the creatures on the board. Oh, and then he puts down his own Rusalka.
Yeah, he put down his own Rusalka, and that's when I realized, oh, his deck has a lot of synergy, because he just played 2 creatures that he can sacrifice for.
Yeah, so here's Chandra's Outrage.
Yeah, so I got some instant speed removal that I'm feeling like I'm in a pretty good situation for setting him up.
Okay, so here's a question. Say you attack with both your dudes. He blocks with two of his. He blocks with the beetle and the mod flunkies. If you burn out the beetle, is the flunky still blocking?
Yes. Yeah, there's no way. Once he's declared the block, there's no way of pulling it out of that. Okay. So it's committed at that point, regardless of how things may change otherwise.
But now you have a 4-4 golem. So who cares?
Yeah, so I just figured I'd get some bodies down that would stop him from attacking in, and I could set him up for a better turn on... What I was hoping for with the Chandra's Outrage was to set him up for some kind of multi-block or sacrificing a bunch of creatures to make his Mortician Beetle huge and then getting rid of...
Yeah, burn out the beetle before it gets the counters. That. Yep. Yeah.
As I describe what I hope happens, I don't even remember what happens, so this is exciting for me too.
Yeah, we shot this last night, so not that long ago, but Brandon and I was going to say we do a lot of drugs, but that's not true. We sleep a lot?
That's very true.
I think our opponent's a little nervous about this board state. He starts getting... Oh, and Brandon just...
That was an excited untap. Man, I'm on the edge of my seat. What am I going to do?
He's actually sitting on the edge of his seat here because he doesn't remember what he's about to do. Oh, I hope it's good.
I don't think I want to play the Hellrider yet. Because he's got stuff that'll just trade with it. If I do, I don't want to swing with it, for sure. I mean, in general, his blockers... Like, our creatures are about equal level, but if I attack in, he gets to make all his decisions, and it's just not good for me.
Yeah. I never want my opponent to make choices. Unless they're bad choices.
No, I mean, that's... that's a legitimate strategy. Just don't let them make choices. So instead of playing either of the cards, I decided to pass out and just fall asleep sitting up, apparently.
You do sleep a lot.
Let me tell you guys, I took some drowsy allergy meds a couple days ago, and I think the cameras at work caught me falling asleep standing up.
Yeah, you just shipped the turn. You didn't do anything.
Yeah, so yeah, I was waiting to hopefully do something cool with that Chandra's Outrage.
I mean, I guess that's fine too, because you can use the Chandra's Outrage, or you've got the Rusalka up in case he tries to throw some removal your way. You can get a little value out of it.
I think I was just hoping he would attack in with some grand plan.
Yeah, man, sitting there, these games felt really long, but now... As I watch it again, I realize you guys just took really long turns.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't know how I stayed awake.
So there was a bunch of public information on the table. Both sides could sacrifice creatures. We both knew his creature could get bigger at his will. So, like, there's a bunch of stuff. Like, every tiny move, there's a lot of math to do for the potential outcomes. And that's not even counting things that we don't know, which, you know, if we had a pile of secrets in our hands, that would be easier because you can't account for that.
Mm-hmm.
So then you just make decisions and they surprise you. But when the tricks are on the table, that's when games slow down.
Yeah.
It was a bummer. We had those two golems dancing in our draft video earlier, and we couldn't find any golems when I made my golem token there, so that's what that face-down card is.
Yeah, I ran around looking for golem tokens. We actually managed to find one after this round. And we did get to use it, didn't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, you cast it one more time.
Oh man, I'm doing a nervous finger dance. I got a lot of ADD going on or something.
That's all the Mountain Dew you drink. It makes you twitchy.
Yeah. All right, so yeah, I caught him in a time where he couldn't sacrifice enough other creatures to survive and keep it alive, but he still sacrificed it in response so that he didn't take the two extra damage and got the damage back at me.
Oh, that's cool.
So he lessened the value I got out of it, but I made sure to do it at a time where I could still kill that beetle. Because he honestly, he could have made that thing a 7-7 in no time.
Oh, the Hookmaster's... Skyfisher. I will never get those two cards right.
Mix max it every time.
I'm looking at it. I can read it. And I called it the wrong thing. That guy does a lot of work for you right now.
Yeah, I've got a lot of options if I need to gain life or get more creatures. So I swing in with the 4-4. I know he could actually make a very efficient double block for himself. But he doesn't know I'm not holding tricks. So I think it's also kind of smart for him to not double block. But he's got the 3-3 and the 1-3. If he double blocked, I could only kill one of them. And I would lose my 4-4. But I was glad he didn't. So at this point, I play the Skyfisher, bring back the Golem Makey guy. Make another golem. So I've got another 4-4.
We actually had two tokens. If you remember from the draft portion of the video, we had two Golem tokens. And it was my job to pick him up. And I even asked him if he wanted the tokens. I think at that point we had just made a thought golem joke.
We are very funny. Tell your friends.
Please, please tell your friends. Now he's trying to decide how to attack? What to do with the cards in his hand? If maybe he should find a new hobby? It's unclear.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so he played this card, which I know is amazing. And when he declared it, I freaked out because I didn't remember what he was getting. But then when I realized all he was getting was Mortician Beetle, I was like, okay, that's not too terrible. But it also pumps his team +2/+0, which would be scarier if I were lower on life.
Yeah. But yeah, I think I was feeling all right. 24 still.
His plan was to pop it out and just swing with everything, and then he like started to did a little bit of math and was like, "Oh, pastor." Yeah. And then I had a tough decision to make.
Yeah.
So I decided to just show him the one that he saw already because he doesn't know that I've got two at this point.
Now your board's pretty dumb.
So. One really cool thing I like about being on camera for playing Magic is that I feel like because of that, none of my opponents scooped early. Everybody waited for the final attack, and I think it's because the camera was on and they wanted to give us the courtesy of showing us the end of each game.
Yeah.
Whereas normally people are a lot faster to be like, oh, I see the Hellrider next game. And, you know, it's like an extra 10 seconds, but it's more fun to swing with a Hellrider than to just show somebody a Hellrider. So that made it more interesting.
All right, this hand.
Yeah, I'm feeling good about that.
Yeah, this hand's fine.
You got
a one drop, a two drop, a three drop.
Yeah, in two cases of first strike, bam.
Mm-hmm. Get him.
First strike, which nobody else cares about.
Oh, no, this is important because they have 4 minutes to play this game.
Oh, yeah.
We go to time.
Everybody stand around. Play fast. Yeah. Play fast.
And then our opponent mulligans to five. I wanted to hit him.
Yeah. thankfully, if it were somebody I didn't know, I would be like, oh, this person's just mulliganing to waste time, so we just draw. But he's a good kid, and I knew that wasn't the intent. But yeah, definitely, we had 4 minutes left, and then he mulliganed twice. It's like, okay, let's play with 2 minutes. Oh, yeah, he was the one with those beautiful, beautiful baby blue sleeves.
He was sitting across from us while we were drafting, yep. I say we were drafting like I somehow participated.
I mean, you were basically sitting on my lap, so...
It's really awkward as the cameraman because I have thoughts and opinions on the things that Brandon is doing, but I can't tell him to pick a different card or cast a different spell or even say, oh man, that's a really hard choice, because that's providing information to him and I'm outside the draft. So it's a sort of bizarre experience for me.
That doesn't stop him from occasionally making fun of me after I get blown out, which is perfectly acceptable. Oh yeah, my little trumpeter dude.
I like the art on that guy. It reminds me of like, you ever seen like The Sword and the Stone? It's a movie about...
Yeah.
It's an old Disney movie from
reminiscent
like the
60s. Of that.
And for whatever reason, it reminds me of that
movie. Ooh yeah, ripping some more miracles, baby.
Oh, do 5 damage to something.
Yeah, so he had an interesting combination of things there because I didn't want to kill a Sprouting Thrinax. Because then he was going to have 3 tokens, and he was still going to be able to block with his Mog Flunkies.
Yeah, this was the interesting question I wanted to ask you, right? Because you target the Flunkies. The Flunky can't block without the Thrinax, but I had forgotten that the Thrinax makes 3-1
tokens. Yeah, so removing that wasn't going to get rid of anything. So yeah, that felt weird, but it was still a really good rip for that turn, because it let me maximize my mana.
Mana.
I know. I've said mana my whole life. Then somebody corrected me. We looked it up, and the appropriate pronunciation is mana. Whatever. They're both acceptable. We're nerds. I'm not even very consistent with it. I'll go back and forth.
Clearly.
we're staring at each other lovingly right now. Yeah, I'd never seen this card. I think it gave it trample and gave him two tokens. That's annoying. I just want to end this game. But now he's got a million blockers. If I kill one of his blockers, he gets more blockers. Thankfully, that little trumpeter makes it where his target creature can't block. So that was probably the only card in my deck that was going to let me keep attacking because of that Thrinax. Because any of my other removal on the Thrinax, he was still going to have a bunch of blockers.
I wish I had remembered to take a note about when turn zero starts. But I don't remember which turn it was.
It was on his... He was turn zero, but I don't remember exactly when. Yeah, this might be turn one here because I was aggressively attacking in with even my Rusalka, which wasn't actually super efficient for me. Oh yeah, this is the point where I'm like, you don't want to block that way. He's trying to put his 2/1/1s in front of my 2/1 first strike. I was like, don't do that.
Yeah, he didn't realize that it had text. He thought it was just...
Yeah, it was all flavor text. I was like, that wouldn't be in Modern Masters. So at that point, I basically just told my opponent to block more efficiently so I lose my Rusalka. So I kill it with first strike and then manage to still sacrifice it to push the damage through to his face.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, because it's a 1/1 with first strike. So first strike damage kills one token, and then you can sacrifice it before combat damage.
Yep.
Man.
So I got to kill something and deal damage to his face, which, you know, again, not super efficient because I like that Rusalka, and I could have used it as a finisher, but I just wanted to keep swinging aggressively, which ironically may have been the less aggressive move because of losing him. Oh yeah, at this point, he didn't exactly concede, but he knows his chances are slim, so he plays Giant Baiting and swings at me with two 4/4s again, so deal 8 damage to my face. So he's also playing to his outs and his potential of ways to win. We're both aware that we could have stalled out, like it wouldn't have been too terribly difficult for him to play on the defensive and probably just take us to time. But I think both of us were thankfully on the same page of, we want one of us to win. Which I don't think was super efficient for him, but...
I mean, from a prize standpoint, and I guess there's money on the line, so it would have made sense to play for the draw. But I wouldn't be surprised to learn after the fact that the camera made him want to play out as well.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, that I wouldn't be surprised either now that you mentioned that. Which is an unfortunate effect. I don't want to have that effect on people to make them play differently, but that could be true. We'll do some studies. Boom. Hellrider. I don't have an official list of favorite Magic cards or some number, but I'm sure Hellrider's on my top 50.
He's cool. We should do Brandon Manning's top 50 Magic cards and make that official list.
Yeah, let us know if you want us to do that, because I promise there's going to be some weird ones. I was so excited to play Hellrider. He just killed it immediately with Augur Spree, and then my level of enjoyment was reduced to zero as I kill him. So I believe this was my turn 3.
So he's going to his final turn 5, right? If I recall. Oh,
spoiler alert.
God. Ruin everything.
Yeah, Dragon Fodder made me consider that I might not be able... Oh, yeah, actually, I couldn't have won there, and then I draw the Chandra's Outrage. 2 damage to his face, and removing a blocker made all the different... I had to sit and think about it. I was like, oh, no, I think he was at 2. Even.
Yeah, he was at 2.
That's right, yeah. So the spell just had to resolve was all I needed.
Oh yeah, 2 damage. Look at that. Chandra's Outrage.
So I was relieved because had I not drawn that, it would have been a draw.
Yep. All right, and then we start round 2. And I've gotten to move to the end of the table. There's nobody around me, so I have a lot more mobility. We're looking at his first hand. Maybe
we got so much mobility that you decided to do an exercise routine while holding the camera.
That's a cool looking swamp. Oh, and then you gain a bunch of life.
Well, you didn't say anything about how cool my plains and mountains were.
I play a lot of black, Brandon. Yeah, I don't really draft, but I do enjoy Commander, and I like Sealed. So I do play Magic. I will draft occasionally if I have an extra $12. But he doesn't have any blockers, so screw him.
Yeah, I was excited about this. Just curving out with creatures. Nothing threatening coming back from him. And then he played a 1-3. And
what do you do about that?
I don't. Don't do anything about that.
Nope, it blocks two of the creatures on the table right now. And the other one just bounces off it.
So the amount of times people will just take damage when otherwise the creatures would bounce off each other just because they're afraid of a combat trick, I more often than not will swing in even if I expect nothing to happen. Because very frequently people will just take it.
It's the chump check.
Yeah.
Gotta check for that chump. I don't know what happened here. Oh, I changed batteries, I think. Yeah, I had to change batteries. That's what it was, because that last game went so long.
So now I have four first strike creatures, but he's got a 1-3 that's bigger than my army and a 4-4 flyer that I can't stop.
Remember how excited you were about this?
I was so excited. Then I've got a flyer, and I decide to gain some more life. I don't soul bond it. Because I decide I'll use the flyer on its own and then just have more first striking ground forces. Basically giving more value to my 2-1 since I already have some value and utility out of having a flyer. Yeah, this guy's deck scared me quite a bit.
It was very good.
At first it came out so slow I thought I was just going to murder him before he did anything, and then it was just efficient utility creatures.
He had some really neat tricks, some cool spells and enchantments and stuff. This is a puzzler. What am I going to do? Untap. Draw a card. Ooh.
So as soon as I see that magma jet, I realize immediately that I soul bonded incorrectly. And I should have given the flyer for a strike. But I just wasn't thinking about my potential draws at that time. Because I'm willing to trade my core Skyfisher and the Magma Jet to kill that 4-4 flyer.
Sure.
But if I'd soul bonded the other way, I would have only had to trade the Magma Jet for that flyer.
It would have been better. Because then you'd still have the Skyfisher. Skyfisher. Yeah, because
that one's that's flying. The right one this time.
All right.
I was hoping in some off chance he would maybe want to kill the first striker instead. I managed to push 2 damage through that way as well. So I went ahead and just let my creature die first before we did this.
And then...
Yeah, I thought it was worse than that. I was like, oh, okay, he's just going to counter it, and then I'm just destroyed. He just played Forbidden Alchemy. James tried to look at his hand, which...
I didn't try. I wanted to look at the spell, and then I realized I could see his hand.
Thankfully, that didn't help me see his hand. And this is my Scry 2. Don't need the land for sure, and I love that Hellrider. Especially when I've got a pile of creatures. So next turn, I'm going to swing with Hellrider and 4 other creatures total.
Okay.
I've got 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. I'm going to have 15 damage coming out of next turn.
Yeah, and that's insane. So now he attacks with a 1-3.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, he's got something. There's got to be something.
I mean, there's obviously... A combat trick here, which is why I sat and thought about it for a while. I was like, wow, what could it be? And then I realized I don't know the set well enough.
Yeah.
So, like, what's the worst that's going to happen if I just take it? So
but I'm like,
block.
Oh, man.
It's just 1 point of damage.
Yeah. What's the worst that could happen? And then I'm like, hey, can I see your hand? Oh, that's what's going to happen.
At this point, keep in mind, I only browsed the list briefly 15 minutes before we started drafting. And well, as I know Damnation's in the set. I guess I could have counted on that. I forgot Terminus was around also. So I sack a couple things to Scorch Rasaka because that's all I got going for me in life. Everything else is bottomed.
I feel like he came out ahead there a little bit.
A little bit. Anyway, so I went from dealing, 15 damage with this Hellrider to dealing 4.
I mean, even so, I feel like that's a good recovery after a blow.
Yeah, yeah, that's a real good one to drop right after. I wasn't super sad about that. I just wish I had a second creature. Because I'm holding a Plains.
Oh, you know who would have been sweet? Goblin Guide.
Yeah, that would have been a good rip.
But then
that would have been 7 damage that turn. Another Plains. Not super exciting.
We found the Plains at the end of the tunnel. They're in Brandon's
hand. So, usually, and this is giving away a personal secret of mine, I'll usually just bluff one land at a time in case I just need to maximize my mana. Then the worst case scenario, I just play that last land I'm bluffing on a turn so I can have all the mana available. Occasionally, I think everybody does that. So occasionally, I'll bluff the second land in the hand and risk myself being behind a mana at a later turn, just because everybody always assumes you're bluffing one land, but not necessarily two. So here, I was holding two Plains as he plays Soul Ransom on my Hellrider. I forgot what this card did. I remembered playing it and playing against it. I think it was a rare originally. And it's not... It's fine.
Yeah.
It's not... Super phenomenal. It's good as an uncommon. Yeah. It was kind of a disappointing rare. So the whole premise is that it's a control magic, but the creature's owner can discard 2 cards. I have to double check it. I had to read it like 3 times. Like, make sure I'm doing this right. The creature's owner can discard 2 cards to destroy it. And then the Soul Ransom's owner gets to draw 2 cards in response. So... Basically, what it was 4 mana, I discard 2 cards, and he draws 2 cards. But that's much better than if he got to keep my Hellrider. So I was really lucky I happened to decide to hold on to 2 Plains at that moment.
Oh, good.
Not so lucky to continue seeing more land. I would kill for that to be Chandra's Outrage. Get rid of that flyer and keep beaten face. I'm kidding. I wouldn't have killed for it. I don't take magic that seriously.
I would have killed for it. Oh, that's...
Removal spell. It's the seal of kill non-black creature.
What's that? Oh, that's fine.
Amazing card.
But...
Yeah, you know he's going to kill my Hellrider as soon as I do anything, any quick movements. Trying to think if there's some way I can finagle my way out of him not killing my Hellrider, but
Maybe there's no way.
Oh, I didn't even think about that. You know, these wizards, we're like battling each other. We're always waging war against each other. We never just...
Oh, he just counters it instead.
Oh, yeah. I forgot. I completely forgot. Man, it would have been an okay turn, but not even game-winning if I'd gotten to steal his 4-4 for a turn. But no, he counters it, gets a 4-4, kills my guy.
No, he gets a 5-5.
5-5, yeah. Sorry. Those were all my best cards. I don't know. Like, that was... And they... Yeah. This guy destroyed me. He had like a modern level control deck. And I think that was another 4-4 flyer or something I wasn't even familiar with. Oh, this was cute. So I got that Ranger of Aeos, and it doesn't matter at this point, obviously. It's not saving me. But I chose to sacrifice my other creatures from that Cursed Rasulka earlier, so that Terminus bottomed my Cursed Rasulka.
Yeah.
And I only have the 2. So I inadvertently made the right choice that I could get the value.
But the game was over.
Yeah, I figured that out, and then I decided I didn't want to show him my Ranger of Eos, so I was just like, I'm done.
All right, so now we're on, this is game two.
Yeah, match two, game two. I'm not super excited about this hand, but I can play it.
Yeah,
and in limited, that's usually all I care about.
Yeah, right, the missionary keeps you alive till you can get to the Hellrider.
And I draw that land, and I immediately, my heart sinks a little. I'm like, I'm just going to get a bunch of lands, and it's game over.
Yep.
I've seen his deck. Like, I can't win with a bunch of lands.
That's what I thought, too. I thought for sure you were done. He was just, this is where the gravy train stopped. You found the plains at the end of the tunnel, and then you stayed there.
Just stayed there. Even though I drew another 4-drop, which I would have preferred a 3-drop on that turn, I was happy it was that because I wanted to get another big creature out and then have more creatures out for when I dropped Hellrider eventually. Also, I didn't want to play Hellrider into that Seal of Killed non-black creature again. So I'd have been real happy had he burnt that on any of my creatures. Oh yeah, we got our golem, our little dancing golem guy.
There he is. Remember, hey, we got the token jingle? This time. I had to hunt for it. Oh, then there's a Ranger of Eos.
Yeah, so I was faced with some decisions here. I was maybe making less than efficient plays because I was playing around the potential of him having Terminus again.
Sure.
I didn't want to empty my hand. So ideally, I'd just drop as many creatures as possible and try and kill him as quickly as possible. But I didn't want to do that if he was going to Terminus me again, because that just would have been a loss.
Yeah.
If I lost 5 creatures to Terminus again.
But Ranger of Eos is a good hedge against that.
Yeah, yeah, that'll give me the card advantage back. I have the mana this turn to play the Ranger and the Goblin Guide. And I was thinking about the possibilities on how badly I would get screwed doing one play over the other in worst case scenario. So I decided not to do that this turn. You know, and
which seems reasonable. You've got a bunch of good threats on the board right
yeah,
now.
You've
got a 4-4 and 3 damage over 2 more dorks.
Generally, I think it's really silly to play around one specific card, especially in limited, where it's likely he only has the one Terminus, and you know, there's 40 cards in his deck. At this point, there's probably still 27 cards that means he's not holding Terminus already.
Abrupt Decay, though.
Yeah. Yeah, I killed my token with that.
But yeah, I see what you're saying. I mean, the chance that he gets Terminus is not great, but if he gets lucky and does rip the Terminus.
The odds were in my favor that I didn't have to worry about that, but I needed to play around. If he did do that, I was just going to lose if I emptied my hand out. Whereas if I played a little slower, it wouldn't have been necessarily most efficient for my plays, but he wouldn't guarantee a win with one spell. So afterwards, I play the Ranger of Eos, go and get my Rusalka and my Goblin Guide. And even though I'm tapped out of red mana, that I can't use that ability right away, I decide to drop it out to maximize my mana and hang on to the Goblin Guide for a later turn since it has haste. And I already skipped my combat anyway. And by skip, I mean I attacked. I would have think about it for a long time, though. I was still really afraid of Terminus. I was like, I don't want to lose another thing. And a part of it was the way he was playing. I thought the way he was keeping just that seal and didn't have more creatures on the board also, I thought he was setting up for the Terminus.
Yeah. Like, we did see a Mystical Teachings at one point. And doesn't that grab an instant or sorcery?
I don't remember that card.
Mystical Teachings? there was a spell in there that I saw during the draft that grabs an instant or sorcery. And Brandon didn't remember it, but I did. And that's what I was thinking about.
I sometimes, once I realize what colors I'm in, I become so streamlined and pay much less attention to the other's colors, which is a huge flaw on my part, but sometimes lets me keep focus.
Man, that 4-4 made me sad. I thought this is where you lose the game again.
I also felt the same way, especially that he had that seal out and still hadn't spent it on any of my creatures. I really didn't want to drop Hellrider and just die immediately.
He used Abrupt Decay on the Golem, and he had the Seal of Doom out. That seems... I don't know. I would have... I guess the Seal of Doom is free to kill a creature, whereas Abrupt Decay costs mana, so maybe he just wanted to use his mana efficiently.
Also, Abrupt Decay wouldn't be able to hit Hellrider, which he knew I had.
Okay, sure.
Because the converted mana cost is 4. That first strike guy, just getting some more bodies out there. And that's that. So I decided, he knows I have the Goblin Guide, but I decided to hang on to it. My thought being, again, playing around the Terminus, which I've said too many times, I spent way too much time doing. I had to read this one. I'm familiar with this card, I just didn't recognize it.
It's goofy.
Yeah, it's just Mind Rot and... Oh, no, sorry, it's a mill to draw two.
Yeah.
Right. I was holding on to the Hellrider and the Goblin, because those would work really well to follow up after a board wipe, because it's immediately 7 damage. They're hitting that turn, and then you've got 2 creatures.
Yeah.
So it's basically holding back for...
So you don't feel bad running out other stuff into the Terminus, because you've got this massive threat.
Exactly.
Yeah. You did lose Madcap skills, which makes me sad, because I love that card, but that's probably one of the better things you could have milled away at this point. Because whatever you put it on just instantly dies to Seal of Doom.
Yeah, yeah. Though, at the same time, I thought if I'd drawn that, then I could have baited the Seal of Doom so that I could have felt safe playing Hellrider.
Yeah, yeah, because you could put it on...
I mean, even a 1-1 would have been fine, because he couldn't have been able to block it at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, what's it going to be, Brandon? This is fun to watch, because I really don't remember what happens most of the time. I remember some game end results, but a lot of the steps on the way.
Yeah, you're thinking really hard about this, too.
Yeah, my brain hurts. You can see it.
Got that furrowed brow.
Yeah.
You need a shave.
Oh, yeah, I know. I'm disgusting.
What did you just cast?
I don't know. Oh, a Goblin Guide. Yeah, I just decided to do it.
We're doing it. We're going for it.
I think I had so much damage. He didn't get to draw a card off the Goblin Guide. I like the idea that he just decides to remove his creature. He's like, I don't want this anymore. Okay, and his life was low enough that he basically, I knew he needed to spend that to kill something if I swung with everything. So that was why I allowed that to happen.
And then I got a 3-2?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I got to sack that to the Rasalka, get some more damage in. I let it deal 2 damage to his 4-4 before sacking the other one to the Rasalka. I didn't actually have a reason in my hand for doing that, but I don't know, just in case something changed.
Sure.
This is good, just free damage I could have let happen.
Mm-hmm.
So he took a bunch to his face. And at this point, I know if he doesn't play Terminus this turn, he doesn't have it, because he had to.
Oh, yeah. I forget what he plays, too. This is exciting. It's like watching it all over again.
Man, I looked angry there. Like, I don't like this opponent, which I did. Everybody I played was a nice guy. Oh, do I just have a resting dick face? Is
that...
Yeah, not excited about land, but I'm fine. We're good.
From a cameraman perspective, I kind of am excited when you draw land, because it's real clear right away what you drew. I don't have to fuss with it at all.
And that was more than enough. Game 3 of match 2.
Hey, this hand looks sweet.
Yeah, I was excited about this. Well, okay, I was a little excited about it. The worry here, I only have one creature. And that creature is going to... sorry, that's not true. I've got one early creature. Oh, God. I wish I could date myself. So I only had one early creature, and that creature was the Skyfisher that was going to set me back a land.
Yep.
So I was like, man, I'm going to play this if I don't draw something else. I'm going to be sad about it.
But on the other hand, that's a two flyer?
2/3 flyer.
2/3
for
flyer.
Two mana. Yeah.
And you can put Madcap skills on it.
Yeah, which I was a little scared to do because I knew he had the
Seal of Doom.
Those
and
seals. Yeah, he had a lot of answers to that.
Mm-hmm.
So I was... It was playable, and that's why I didn't want to throw it back, which is all I really look for in Limited.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if it were constructed, I would maybe be looking for more specific cards or specific combinations, but I wasn't mana screwed. I had some spells. I decided to go for it.
See, I am bad at Magic, so I was really excited about this hand.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to put Madcap skills on that freaking Core Skyfisher.
So I didn't draw another one or two drop, so I was committed to... Unless I briefly thought for a moment, I just don't play this because I just want my lands to come out.
Yeah, I could see that. Core Skyfisher does actually end up causing problems for, I think, your round three opponent.
Yeah.
Maybe it was even this game. I don't remember. But yeah, because of the bounced land. That's one of those cards that you don't necessarily always want to play it on turn two, even though it is technically a two drop.
Yeah. And the thing is, the card is good even if it specifically made you bounce a land. It's still worth it. So if you might notice that next turn went really quick because my opponent just drew and passed, and that's when I noticed, hey, I'm probably safe to play this Madcap skills invested because he's at two islands and nothing else.
Yep.
And he could easily draw a swamp and then Seal of Doom it, but I had to take that gamble because the rest of my hand wasn't super aggressive either.
Oh, sure.
And again, my turn, I've still got that, except now I can put Gift of Orzhova on it. And then I've got a 6-power flyer with lifelink and intimidate. So there's a big life discrepancy here.
Is it intimidate or menace? I thought it was
menace. Yes. Sorry. I was making up cards. And there I am laughing in my opponent's face, apparently, because I am a dick. Man.
Oh, and then... In...
Oh, yeah. And Hellrider on top of that. So... That risky keep panned out for me only because I basically didn't have an opponent that game, unfortunately. Which isn't how I prefer my matches to go.
I bet you said something really funny there.
I know. Everything I say is funny.
All right, so here's round three. Drawing your hand. You have a nice contrast on your playmat. I like how that looks on camera. I mean, everybody's playmats have been nice tonight.
It's a cool playmat anyway. It was a gift that I'm happy to use.
All right, you want to talk about why you threw that back?
When I was playing, I made that decision real fast, but now just watching it, I didn't even see what was there.
Oh, there were no lands. That's what it was.
Oh, that's... Okay. Do you want to talk about why I threw that back?
So there were no lands in his hand, and without mana, you can't play Magic. So he shuffled his hand away, and now he's going to draw a 6.
You're so smart, James.
Yep.
I'm still reeling from that personal attack.
I would keep these three cards.
I drew three, I went keep. And then I saw the other three cards. Whereas I could have used the fourth land, I knew it was likely I was going to draw another one before I needed it. And so I just put that on bottom. I was happy to get that Rusalka turn one frequently through the night. I believe I drafted two, but I only played one in my deck.
Yep. Yeah, you got stuck with one.
After the entire night's draft was done, all the games and everything, I realized I would pick that thing a little higher. Like, I felt like I got stuck with it when we were drafting, but it did a lot of unique things, the Rusalka. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, but he played that Skyfisher. 2/3. Things with 3 toughness were rough for my deck.
Yeah, they were.
I only had a handful of removal and a lot of 2-power creatures.
Yeah, and you only had 4 creatures in the deck that had power 3. Nothing. And then one guy that could make a 4/4 token, which I think you ended up cutting.
No, I always left that one in, but I kept going back and forth with the ones that gave him vigilance that just made the 3/3 token. Or sorry, are we talking about the flying angel?
Protector,
yeah, I did cut the angel maker. So now he's got a First Striker and the Skyfisher. And I wanted to play that Hellrider real bad, but if I attacked in, he would double block and I would only kill one of his things. Which I would not be thrilled about that trade. At the same time, I don't want to not do anything, so I think I just wanted to get more board presence down. Yeah, so I just drop it down anyway. Defensively, a nice defensive Hellrider.
Mm-hmm, because that's what I think when I think about riding into hell.
Yeah, just sitting back and watching the world go.
Yep. Straight there.
Which I always feel weird about playing a Hellrider and not attacking, not just because it has haste, but because then I feel like I'm giving him more time to get rid of it so I don't get anything or plan around it.
Yeah.
But it's okay. I'm at 24 life. How could things go wrong?
I don't remember.
First off, I can't stop a flyer.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
Oh, and he's going to lay down the law with Gideon's Lawkeeper. Is that what that is?
Yep, that's okay. What that is.
So many similar cards of that effect.
I don't quite understand the art on Gideon's Lawkeeper. I mean, it's a dude. He's got some kind of light whip.
Yeah, but he is lashing people. That's how they enforce the law there, apparently.
Oh, okay. Now, Gideon's from Theros, right? Right?
Oh.
Wasn't his whole shtick that he was like a hero? And then he hires this asshole to enforce his laws? I don't know. Doesn't work for me.
White is the color of oppression in Magic, really.
Okay.
It's so white frequently. Power? I mean, really, thematically, it is frequently represented as sort of the hero or good side color, just because the trope of, you know, white and black, like light side, dark side. But, yeah, I mean, white's all about enforcing its power and rules on you.
Also, you just lost your Hellrider.
Yeah, I was sad about that. What he spent, he played Terminate.
Yeah.
To destroy it when I went to combat.
But he still took a bunch. No, he's blocking? I forget.
He took some damage.
We got caught up in our philosophical conversation about the colors of magic.
His First Striker was tapped, and he'd attacked with his 2/3, so. Still tapped, sucker.
Yeah, he said, please remind me that this is going to be tapped. And then Brandon passes the turn, and then he untaps all his things, and then I remind him that it is still tapped. It was kind of a funny exchange. I guess you had to be there. Oh, I didn't even realize the tree on your mat is all the different sets of magic. I've known you for years, and I've only just figured that out.
It was literally every set symbol that existed, even all the rare promos that, like the Xbox 360 controller that was only used for the Garrett promo is on there.
Oh, really?
It was everything that existed at that time that I think was around Theros time. I don't remember if Theros is on there or not, but everything previous.
Man, he's got a big flyer now.
Big meaning 2/2, but too big for me.
Yep. I know it's like a dude riding on a griffin, but I feel like the art makes me think of a much bigger creature. Like, I feel like they didn't use 2/2 art for that guy. I feel like that's
You gotta think the soldier itself is usually represented as a 1/1.
Yeah.
And then a griffin is probably a little more powerful than a soldier.
That creature's at least a 3/3. I want it to be a 4/4.
Yeah, playing some devils, pump my team. I'm not actually in a super efficient spot for maximizing that effect, but I just needed to get a 3/3 on the board. Mm-hmm. I just needed to build up the potential of attacking with more stuff in the future.
And it pumps your team +1/+0, right?
Yes.
So now all your guys can threaten a trade.
Yes,
so
which
if he blocks,
was relevant.
You get rid of his flyers, or Gideon, his little...
Yeah, he definitely wasn't going to block with that. He tapped out his white mana that turn, so I was able to swing comfortably with those. He just takes it. He obviously doesn't want to trade his 2/3 that's been holding back a bunch of damage so far.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nice that he got that 2/2 flyer. He can keep the damage on me while keeping his 2/3 black. 2/3 back.
Is it flying haste or flying vigilant?
The red-white one that he played?
Yeah.
That is Flying Haste.
Okay. Now, they reprinted that, right? Because I know that originally showed up in first Ravnica block. And then it showed up in Gatecrash. with different art. I mean, it was the same art. It was just zoomed in on the soldier guy.
Mm.
History of magic, people. Learn it here. I actually think Sky Knight Legionnaire is one of my top 50 favorite magic cards.
That's interesting.
Yeah, I don't know why. I had a lot of fun drafting Gatecrash.
Played another 2/3 flyer.
It's
That's
fine.
That's trouble for me.
It's fine. You're fine.
I let him bounce his planes, then play it again, so he can still lay down the law with Gideon's Lawkeeper.
It's fine.
Yeah.
I
know it's fine. Gonna bond some souls, get some first strike.
Do you just give the first strike to the 3/3?
That's what I was debating on at this moment. I think that, you know, makes sense a lot of ways, but I think he was likely to tap down the 3/3 anyway.
Sure.
So then I would be wasting that half of the first strike on the soul bond. So I think I bonded something else. Let's see if I follow through with that same thought process here.
That would make sense, because that's what I would have done. I would have just given the 3/3 first strike.
So yeah, I bonded with the 2/1. Even though that might not have necessarily done anything, I was pretty sure he was going to be tapping down the 3/3. But let's find out. Yeah. So, in that ever so slight of a sense, I didn't waste the first strike there, even though I still just couldn't attack it. Nothing matters, it never has.
Again, another aggro deck that's weirdly long.
I'm wondering if this might be a trend, if the set might...
It's more mid-rangey?
Yeah. Or just make itself prone to board stalls, sort of.
There you go, folks. You heard it here first. Modern Masters 2017, mid-rangey. Solved it. Solved the format. Done. Is Mizzium Mortars in this set? I don't think so.
I don't think so.
That's another card on my
list.
But
you know, you watched as much time as I spent looking over the set, so...
I like Mizzium Mortars because I like saying Mizzium Mortars.
Mizzium.
It's just fun to say. Man, you're thinking so hard about this.
Golgari Guildgate is one of my favorite cards to say out loud. It always reminds me of Popeye. Just being,
you made that noise last night and I didn't understand it.
That's probably fine.
God, you look like Magneto over here trying to
I was thinking rip Xavier the metal myself. Out of
your opponent's blood.
Yeah, I can't do anything. Like, it's actually just he has 2/3 flyers and my entire army in my deck is too small to deal with
those. With that.
It doesn't even matter that they're flying, just that they're 2/3s. My first strike doesn't do much when their butts are too big.
On the subject of big butts, which I know is one of your favorite subjects, they reprinted a little Kraken. I think it's one blue for a 0/8.
Oh, what?
There's a 0/8 in the set.
That's not one blue.
Oh. Is it two?
I know there's a 0/4 for one blue.
Well, there's a 0/8 in the set.
Kraken Hatchling, I think.
There's.
I don't know what the 0/8 is.
Yeah, I thought I remember
seeing
a 0/8
in the set.
We're going to look into that
later. All right, and that right there is the sick rip I needed.
Yep, got him.
I decide I'm probably not going to see another Soul Ransom in this match, so I'll play that land. So I unearthed my little devils there to pump my team. I'd sacrificed them at the end of the previous turn to the Scorched Rasalka, specifically so that I could do that. And it's not the most efficient timing for that, again, just like before, but it was kind of just something I could do that turn for the sake of not just skipping a turn entirely. So it's something I wouldn't have to worry about doing in the future when I might want to do other things. If I remember correctly, my demise was on the board here, and my best play was to attack in and hope he played wrong. which sometimes, you know, it's a Hail Mary that your intelligent opponent will just make a mistake, but it happens sometimes. And that's why I almost never scoop a game even a half a turn early. I'll always make life points hit zero.
I mean, he doesn't know if you're running some kind of anthem effect or some kind of pump that'll just blow him out. So it would make a kind of sense to block even though the blocks might be profitable, because like you haven't done much before and all of a sudden you're doing something aggressive.
There was a long period right there where I thought he was doing something else when I went to declare attack. He tapped down my guy, and then I thought he was thinking about doing something else. And then we just sat there in silence for a long time while we were waiting on the other one to do something, because we thought we were waiting on the other one. So it seemed a lot more epic than we just set up for.
Oh, what's this combat? No, I just forgot. Sorry. It's still my turn.
It was just waiting for me to declare attacks, and I stared.
Yeah, because these represent trades, don't they? Oh, he's remembering, yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
He takes a bunch of damage. Suddenly the board looks less bad for you. Still doesn't look great for you.
Nah. Sacrifice that again to the Rusalka, push another point through.
Because it's exiled at the end of the turn anyway.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
Because you unearthed it.
I think those couple flyers there just kill me.
I thought this game had a more interesting end. But I could be wrong. You could just die.
Maybe I just rip a miracle.
Oh, maybe. That was one of the best things about recording this, is people would ask a question about something that was in his hand or something that he did. And we would just say, I don't know, I guess you'll have to watch the video.
I'm holding my breath right now.
I am too. I really forget. Oh, no. What is that?
Oh, yeah. Is that traitorous?
Yeah.
He wanted to steal it and attack me with it. He forgot I could sacrifice it to the Cursed Rusalka's own ability.
Got it.
So I was able to prevent a pile of damage there, deal an extra damage, and he just forgot that I had that available. He knows how it works, just oversight, something I do very frequently. But as it turns out,
eat it.
He blood rushed the rubble belt Maka for that last 3 points. It was exact lethal after that.
Another card I really love is Rubble Belt Maka, because I love saying Rubble Belt Maka.
Is that your top 50 list? Or probably. Just alliteration?
All right, so this is game two of round three. And what do we have?
I'm real happy having both colors and three lands.
Yeah, I see.
I think that's
spells.
The ideal amount of lands I want. Two mountains and a plains. And that's... I'll count on drawing that fourth one before I need it. I think Seance was the only card I had in my deck that had double white, and as you've seen from watching the... Oh, yes, that's true. Gift of Warzoa. They came in and out between rounds, depending on my matchup. I recall against this matchup, I took out both of those and Madcap skills, because I felt like between his Terminate and being able to tap guys down, I was never going to get value out of them. So I decided to push on the aggressive here a little. I just tap down his 2/3. Just so I can push 2 damage through. Not a phenomenal time, but it also got me my creature on the board. Another Lawkeeper. It's funny, we are both...
Sort of red-white-ish?
Yeah, and like he had a little black also, but yeah, we were both red-white with very strong decks.
Yeah. Well, there was a lot of red-white going around.
That could also be indicative of...
I think you got most of the red and he got most of the white.
Yeah, that's true.
You got the Goblin Guide out, right? No?
Yeah, I think that's what that far-left creature is. And then, yeah, I played the Soulbond guy also, so I got...
I want to look at his hand here, but he doesn't want to show it to me.
Yeah, I'm very private about my hand.
All right, fine. Back to the...
Go away, cameraman James. He was very sad about this turn because all he could do is bounce another land, putting himself even further. But he didn't even have the plains. He had that guild gate as his white source, so he couldn't even replay the plain, an untapped white source to utilize the gatekeeper. Or the, sorry, the lawkeeper.
Lawkeeper.
Gideon's police force.
I want that to be a card now. Gideon's Popo.
I think we're gonna watch me think for a really long time here, and then make a stupid decision.
Isn't that what we've been doing all afternoon?
Yeah, but this one is a focus point.
Oh, all right. Well, you just played a plains.
My first mistake.
I don't know why.
I think that was irrelevant. So what I have is Traitorous Instinct. And I'm trying to figure out what is going to be most efficient. Because I've got some options. I can take his Lawkeeper and then tap down one of his other flyers. Or I can take any of his things and swing in. So... Look at me. I'm going to town. Ultimately, after this turn was done, I realized there was an obvious right answer. And, well.
So we'll see what you do, and then you can tell me, because I'm dumb. And I don't get it.
No, you didn't get it when I did what I did. Neither did Micah. I think I even pointed at that. I'm like, I want that Skyfisher. And then I decided to take the Lawkeeper instead.
Yeah. But then you just attack with it.
Yeah. So what I thought was, I was just going to attack with everything. His life was low enough that if he needed to block... Okay, if I took the Skyfisher, it would have been 4 damage. If he wanted to block it to prevent 4 damage as much as possible, he would have still had the Skyfisher I stole at the end of the turn. Mm-hmm. So my thought was, if I stole the Lawkeeper and he wanted to block it, then he would trade both of the creatures and would kill 2 things. Now, that makes sense that far until you think about the entire rest of the game state and how magic works.
Right.
And I'm just prone to occasionally doing goofy stuff like that. He obviously didn't want to block his own creature. I know how threat and effects work, and I just didn't think about it for some reason in that moment. So then he just had all 3 of his creatures, and he blocked 2 of mine. I pretty much threw away this game at this point. He was real low, I think around 5 life at this point, but now he had 3 creatures that were better than my 2 creatures. I was really sad at myself at this point, and especially that we watched this on camera. And for everybody watching me, just know, you know, no matter how good people think you are at Magic, you're still prone to doing shit like this.
Yeah, I do remember sitting there thinking, why doesn't he just take the...
And then I ripped my most bomby card in the deck, thankfully.
Yeah. Okay, so let's just try that turn over again.
Yeah, it was basically, I've been given a second chance from the Planeswalkers themselves. This time, I still take that, but I use its ability to pull a blocker out, and at that point, even if he blocks my biggest one, it's lethal. Oh, yeah, he was left at 3 life, that's right. Because if he blocks the 3-3, the 2-4-4s are still pushing through. So, there were a handful of cards that could have pulled me out of that, but...
So starting round 3, game 3. This one is for all the marbles. Also, you're 2-0 at this point, right?
Yes, yeah. I lost the first game in all 3 matches. Going to game 3... for the winner of our 8-man pod.
So I see 2 lands in this hand. Decided to keep.
Yep. Yeah, largely, if I had a red and white, I felt pretty comfortable, but I also had that Goblin Guide, so I could come out aggressively. Which freaks me out still. Like, I understand Goblin Guide is valuable, but it has a drawback. Even though I know it's the right thing to play a 2-2 with haste on the first turn, I still feel like this could make me lose. So thankfully, he didn't get any value out of it.
That frustrated him all night, because this is not the first time you attack him with Goblin Guide, and he's got nothing out of it. Or maybe it was, and he just gets nothing for a very long time. I forget.
It was the first time against my round 3 opponent, but I also believe my round 2 opponent didn't get any value out of my Goblin Guide. I had a discussion when Goblin Guide first came out with somebody that the issue isn't really that they'll occasionally draw a land, as he just did. Mm-hmm. It's that he's going to dig... He's not drawing that land on the next turn. He's digging deeper to the more relevant spell.
Yeah.
So I just attacked in with it. I was willing to trade if he wanted to double block, which I knew he didn't want to, but I was kind of hoping he would. Just
sure.
Because, that Lawkeeper. Ugh.
Yeah, it's a gross card.
And then also all the cool stuff that the Rusalka can do.
Yeah. Yeah, that would have been a nice...
That three of the four decks we watched tonight were playing.
Yeah, that was a lot of red.
Oh, yeah. Goblin Assault. Which would have been amazing with Hellrider, but I didn't get one. Yeah, this freaked me out because...
Goblin Guide's a goblin?
Okay. Yeah, Goblin Guide. So it makes all goblins that have to attack every turn, which a lot of people don't realize right away. So I have to attack with that Goblin Guide forever.
Mm-hmm.
At this point, I'm resigned to just trying to mill them out with the Goblin Guide.
I did win a game like that in Sealed once. My opponent, we were both stalled out. He drew into his threats at the same time I drew into my answers, and then vice versa. I was drawing my threats, and he drew his answers. And we were just sort of like sitting on Baltic with crap. But he had drawn one more card that game than I had.
Just stalled out.
Yep. So I beat him, because he drew one extra card. The moral of that story, of course, is that drawing cards in Magic is bad.
Yeah, don't ever do that.
Hmm.
And that's why Goblin Guide is valuable. So, this may be apparent to people watching immediately, but it just didn't click in my brain right away, and it wasn't until midway through the next turn that I realized Goblin Assault works really well with Cursed Rusalka, that you mm-hmm. can always get that damage through. Yep.
Also, just out of curiosity, you had the mana open to use the Sunhome Guildmage. Would it have been worth it to pump your team instead of playing the creature?
Getting the two extra damage, no. Then in future turns, since I have another creature, using that pump effect is even more valuable.
Sure.
So I'm not so aggressive that I was willing to just spend mana just for straight damage. I still need to build up board presence, and I think especially because he was having an infinite army of goblins coming at me.
Mm. Yeah, when Goblin Storm.
Goblin Assault?
Yeah. When that card came out, I thought, oh, this is going to end very badly for Brandon.
I also... I thought I was going to have to go on the defensive, which isn't what I want to do with that deck, and especially not after having seen his deck played. So foolishly, I kept attacking.
Yeah. Boy, that was a huge mistake.
So I've got a 2-1. I don't want to trade it with this stupid little goblin.
You did just get the Lone Missionary, though, so that's 4 extra life. That's like a nice little goblin buffer.
Yeah, and... very relevant in this current board state. Even though life totals aren't low, it lets me go a few more turns without worrying about making inefficient trades or blocks.
Mm-hmm. I know early in a person's Magic career, people will value cards that just straight gain life a lot more highly than they should.
Yeah, sort of the misconception that it's a life game, that whoever's winning has more life and whoever's losing has less life. But it's a card game, and it's usually based more on, having more card advantage, ideally on the board or often in your hand.
Yeah, it's all about resource management. So if you play a card to gain 5 life, you didn't really change up the calculation of the board very much. You just gained a bunch of life. But a card like Lone Missionary puts a guy on the table who can attack and block and... you can target with spells, who can be targeted by removal, who just gunks up the works. The fact that it gives you extra life is what makes the life good.
Yeah, a lot of players will say that life gain is bad, which it, just straight life gain is not super effective, but incidental life gain, where it's an extra effect from something else, is I love it.
Oh, yeah.
So now I've got some options. I can start... pooping out some dudes with my little Sunhome guy. I've got the 4 mana for that, or I can get a couple options. I think I'm holding the Hellrider there already.
Oh, he taps down the Guildmage.
Yep. He wants me to keep swinging with that goblin guide.
He's trying to dig for land.
So I can mill him faster.
Yeah.
And I could have made the decision to not... Oh, no. Sorry.
You can't.
I didn't have that choice.
We just had that conversation.
Yeah. Goblin assault. I had to attack. All right. And I used the pump effect from the Sun Home to make a trade with his 2-3 flyer. So at that point, and I think we discussed it afterwards, I didn't say anything. I wasn't sure if my opponent knew that I had to attack with the Goblin Guide every turn. He was aware, as it turns out, but I didn't announce it or remind it so that he might be trying to figure out if I have a combat trick or something.
Sure.
Each turn.
I know, I didn't realize that. I didn't even realize that the card gave Goblins haste. I just thought you were being a crazy man. Because I don't really read magic cards before I play them. Which is the problem when I actually want to go play them. Find out they don't work that way.
At this point, I feel like I'm losing, and I don't... Oh yeah, he steals that. Well, I have nothing but my 2-1. And he's swinging at me with, I believe he did Traitorous Instinct, so it's a 4-2. I got a pile of goblins. My life total is still pretty high because he hadn't hit me for much, and I gained some life. So I just take it all straight to the face.
All over his face.
Oh, yeah.
All over his resting dick face.
Hmm.
But don't worry, you got a lone missionary. You're fine.
Yeah. Oh, and I didn't block the 4-2. Okay, that was a silly mistake. I forgot he had the cursed Rusalka. So I didn't even block it. So I took the 4 because I didn't want to kill my Sun Home guy.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, he just sacrificed it for another damage to me anyway. So that was a lot of damage I didn't need to take.
But if you had blocked it...
He probably wouldn't have sacked it. He probably would have traded and he would have killed both my creatures.
Yeah. So what?
I think my life total was good enough that I was still better off keeping the creature, but I didn't even
consider
evaluate the decision.
Yeah. But it's fine because now you got that guy.
And having Hellrider will change anybody's day for the worse. And by anybody, I mean the player that doesn't have Hellrider. Look at me menacingly waving my pen at him.
Hey, you kid!
I will write angry notes about you.
Killed the lone missionary. What did he? What was the removal spell? I missed it.
Oh, he traded with his cursed Rusalka. He decided it had done enough work. Which, it had done a lot of work, and I think getting rid of my 2-1 was good for him, but he also had a bunch of goblin tokens, so...
Yeah.
I remember not feeling like he made a bad decision, but it does seem like there's a lot of opportunity if he hung on to it. Oh, let's see. So yeah, he was too low on life, I think, that he didn't want to just take that extra 2 damage and leave me with a creature. But that's the guy you can sacrifice another creature to deal 2 damage. But I am holding a Steely effect.
Steely Dan.
That's what we're going to call him in the future.
From now on, Steely Dan.
It might even be a lady depiction on the card, in which case it can be Steely Danielle.
Sure.
But we'll evaluate that. So I'm double checking a lot of math, but I think specifically because he played the guy that I could sacrifice. This is very advantageous to me. Not to mention I've got a haste creature, which is gonna pile up and be sweet with Hellrider effect.
Or just 5 to the dome.
Yeah, so I play Steely Dan or Danielle, and want to steal his sacrifice for 2 damage guy. Thankfully, giving it haste and having a red mana open for it. And then I was still debating whether I wanted to stick it to his face, or if I wanted to kill his Lawkeeper.
Well, he taps down the Hellrider, but that's fine.
Natch.
What did you just say to me?
Natch.
Natch.
It's like a
Like naturally?
It's a cool bro term for naturally, yeah.
Oh, I didn't know we were bros.
We're...
I thought we played children's card games.
Yeah, we're like the cool kind of bros.
Oh, all right. Who play children's card games?
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
Natch. So yeah, just bang him for three with the Inquisitor.
Why don't you attack him with his creature?
It has to tap to sack for its ability.
Okay.
So I'm holding that Thunderous Wrath, the 5 damage to the face. So my thought was, he's at 3 life now. I could sack that and deal 2 damage to his face to put him to 1, so that even if he played a lone missionary, I would still be able to burn him out the next turn. But I decided there's too many variables, and I was a little scared that if he had a team pumping effect, I wanted to get rid of his Lawkeeper instead.
Sure. Oh yeah, because if he gave all those goblin tokens plus 2 plus 0, that represents an extra... That's 3, 6, 9, 10, 11, 12. Yeah.
Yeah, which I'm at 13 life here. So if I left him with that Lawkeeper and he had that spell, I would have just lost.
Yep. Instead, he plays a guy we don't care about. Attacks for damage we don't care about.
You can tell when I'm feeling good because I untap very excitedly.
Yeah.
Everything untaps very quickly when I have a good plan.
You also don't hold your hand.
Oh, man, maybe that's my tell.
Maybe.
I need to work on that.
Well, hopefully nobody at Common Room Games will watch this video. but we want to thank you guys for watching. And keep an eye on our channel. We haven't figured out exactly how this works yet or what our release schedule is going to be. So just keep watching.